Welcome to Living Life. Do you remember the day that you went to college and for the first time all by yourself, no parents around, no siblings around, and you had to make decisions for your own life? It actually caused you to grow up. That's kind of how I felt when I went off to school. I had to grow up. I had to make decisions for me, and it was really a transition from that child or youth to being an adult, not just from the standpoint of age, but really from the standpoint of how I thought and my thinking and that kind of process. So as we look at the passage today, we're going to see this same kind of thing that Paul is trying to talk to and discuss with the Corinthian church. So let's take a look at the passage and see how it all plays out.
First Corinthians chapter 13, verses 8 through 13. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
Welcome back to Living Life. As I mentioned, when I went to college and had to make decisions for myself, my thinking changed, everything changed, because it was now me alone, without my parents, without my siblings. But this important, I think important concept that came about there that would helps us. And I think Paul grasps that concept, and he grasps that understanding for us in this particular passage. Paul begins the passage by saying love never fails, continuing this idea that love is the most excellent way, because love is a superlative, as we would say. It is the highest and the best way to live out one's life. One's life is lived with a life of love. So he says it never fails. But then he also talks about prophecies. He said prophecies will cease, and also tongues will cease or be stilled. But he says love will always remain. And he brings that idea to play based upon the fact that God himself, God is love. God doesn't do love, but God is love. And God is eternal, and God will always exist. God is the Alpha, he's the Omega. He's the beginning, he's the end. He will always exist. And so, and when we are in relationship with him, we are in a relationship with an eternal God. It's in a relationship that's not temporary, but we have eternal life, and it's a relationship that will last with our Lord and with our Savior and with our God forever. So love will always remain. So Paul is bringing this discussion in his letter to the Corinthians about love and remaining. He tells them, he says, we know in part now, but we don't know fully. But when completeness comes, he says, we will know more. But then he says, also when we see, when we come face to face, who's he? What's the reference here? Well, the obvious reference is to Jesus Christ. When we see him face to face, the scriptures talk about that on that day when we see him. So when completeness comes and when we see him face to face, and we will know fully, not partially, when Jesus returns again. And at that time, when we are glorified in his presence, that's the day when we will begin to know him fully. Now, at that time, there'll be no more need for faith. Because our faith, which brought us through that point in terms of believing that we could be forgiven and believing in the finished work of Christ on the cross so that we can receive the benefit of salvation, that faith wouldn't be necessary anymore, because now Jesus would be coming to take his church, to bring them home. In the prophecies would not be needed any longer either. We wouldn't need to prophesy anymore, because the prophecy would be fulfilled in Christ. We wouldn't need hope any longer either, because our hope would now be reality with Christ being present with us. So prophecies, tongues again would not be needed, because we would be in the presence of God and would be able to speak to him, would be able to commune with him, as the Bible says, face to face. So the one thing that will remain is love. Love will remain. Faith, which is very important to our walk. And the Bible says, without faith, you can't even please God. We walk not by sight, but we walk by faith. Hope, very important, because we hope in God. And Jesus Christ, who's in us, is the hope of glory. So faith and hope, very important to our walk before Jesus returns. But then there is love, that agape love that I talked about earlier, that selfless love, that sacrificial love that purchased us on that cross when Jesus died for us. He gave his life for us. And the Bible tells us that there is no greater love, no greater love than a man that has than this, than a man that would lay down his life for his friends. Jesus laid down his life for us. He showed us what real love was. When he had his arms open wide on that cross, nailed to the cross, and his feet were nailed, and the blood rushed from his side, he showed us how much he loved us. Love will remain. Love is forever, because God is eternal, and God, who is our Savior, is forever. Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Do you know the love of God? Has God captured your heart? Has God overwhelmed your life with his love? If you have not experienced the love of God, today is your day. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for every moment that you give us. We thank you for your overwhelming. We thank you for your love that has captured our souls, captured our hearts. And I pray, if there's someone out there that doesn't know you today, I pray that your love will also capture their heart and capture their soul for all eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
CCTV는 시청자 여러분의 소중한 후원으로 제작됩니다.